الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. أما بعد. So we were doing the chapters regarding the pillars of Iman, and we talked about Iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second pillar of Iman, which is unanimously agreed upon, is the pillar of Iman in the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A believer is not a believer until he or she believes in the Malaika. And the concept of Malaika is one that comes under what is called ilm al-ghayb. The very first verse in the Quran, Allah talks about الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ, those who believe in the unseen. So the Malaika, the angels, are a part of the world of the unseen. We cannot prove them scientifically. We cannot measure them. It is something that we must believe in. And we are tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this belief. So all of the knowledge we have of the Malaika, it comes from our sources. It comes from the Quran and the Sunnah. It is not something that we can derive merely by thinking or contemplating. And from what we know, and of course this is again, as usual, a summarized lecture, from what we know that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us and is found in the Quran, that the Malaika are a separate species created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from light. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the Malaika have been created from Nur, and the jinn have been created from Nar, and mankind has been created from a mixture of clay. So Nur, light, is the source of the Malaika. And Nar, fire, is the source of the jinn, and we have been created from clay. And we also know from the Quran, the story of Adam, that the angels were created many, many millennia before us. And when Allah Azza wa Jalla announced that we would be created, the angels questioned Allah, which means that they had been here for many, many eons before. We also know that the Malaika, generally speaking, are more powerful than us, and they can travel faster than us, and they have specialities that we do not have. And of those specialities is they worship Allah constantly, and they never get tired. Of those specialities is they do not eat, they do not drink, they do not need to sleep, they do not procreate, they do not marry and have children. The same Malaika that existed at the creation of Adam and before, those same Malaika exist right now. The Malaika do not procreate and die, and then another generation comes. This is unique for us and for the jinn as well. Also, we know that generally speaking, the Malaika are a very beautiful creation of Allah. They're very handsome. Only the Malaika that are in charge of punishment are terrifying. Otherwise, the default in the Malaika is that they are very handsome. And that is why when Jibreel would come to this world and he would show himself as a human being, he would choose the shape of the most handsome Sahabi. And his name was Dihya al-Kalbi. Dihya al-Kalbi was the most handsome amongst the Sahaba. And whenever Jibreel would come and he would walk the streets of Medina, and other Sahaba would see him, they would not see him except as the shape of Dihya. He would take on the form of the most noble and the most handsome of the Sahaba. Because the Malaika, generally speaking, are known to be handsome and very light-giving entities. As well, some of the Sahaba saw the angels in their original forms, because the angels, obviously, they can take shape because they're created out of light. It is narrated that one Sahabi was reading the Quran at Fajr time, and he saw what he called a chandelier of lights. He saw a group of lights just come down and listen to him, and his animals became scared and they began basically moving up and down, so he stopped reciting. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that was the Malaika. They came close to listen to your recitation. So this also shows that once in a while, Allah can bless a non-prophet to see an angel. But if a non-prophet sees an angel, he doesn't become a prophet. It is only a specific type of angel, Jibreel, who comes with a specific message that makes a human being a prophet. We also know that the greatest of the angels are magnificent and far beyond our imagination. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that he saw Jibreel in his original form only twice. And when he saw him, he blocked the entire horizons. Jibreel was larger than everything on the horizons. And Allah says in the Quran in Surah An-Najm, لَقَدْ رَأَى مِنْ آيَاتِ رَبِّهِ الْكُبْرَى, that the Prophet ﷺ saw of the biggest signs of Allah. And this has been interpreted to mean he saw Jibreel in his original form. So Jibreel is of the mightiest signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in one hadith, our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah has allowed me to tell you about those angels that carry his throne. Hamalat al-Arsh is a category of angels. Between the lobe of that angel, the earlobe and the neck, is the distance of 700 of your years. Just between the neck and the ear of that angel is the distance of 700 years. Which means that that angel obviously is beyond our human comprehension. And of course, of the most important characteristics of the angels, they never disobey Allah. They never disobey. They don't have the capacity to disobey. They are constantly in Allah's obedience and constantly in Allah's worship. يُسَبِّحُونَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ لَا يَفْتُرُونَ They praise Allah night and day, and they never get tired. يُسَبِّحُونَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ They're saying, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah. They're doing the adhkar, and they're constantly praising. No eating, no drinking, no sleeping, never getting tired. That is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them. And the malaika are not a species that are cut off from us. They are involved in our lives. They are surrounding us, even though we do not see them. They are around us at all times. And our job as Muslims is to try to get their presence, because their presence is mercy. Their coming is mercy. Their demeanor is mercy. Whenever they come, they bring Allah's mercy with them. So there are ahadith that tell us that when we do certain things, the angels come. When we do certain things, the angels pray for us. When we do certain things, the angels lower their wings on us. So we're supposed to study those ahadith. We're supposed to implement those things, so that we can get the companionship of the angels. And of course, the greatest interaction that angels have with mankind is the interaction that they have with the prophets of Allah. Unique interaction. That is the interaction called wahi, or inspiration. And we know that the greatest of angels, because not all angels are the same, the greatest of angels, which is Jibreel, has been chosen by Allah to be the primary angel that has come to every single prophet, from Adam to Nuh to Ibrahim to Musa to Isa to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and all the prophets in the middle. That one angel consistently came down to teach and preach and to give Allah's wahi to the prophets. And other angels interact with all of us. We know that there are angels that write down what we do. كِرَامًا كَاتِبِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ مَا تَفْعَلُونَ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ There are angels that are around us, Muslim and non-Muslim. Every human being is surrounded by angels that are recording. But this is something most Muslims don't know. Righteous people are blessed with angels to protect them. Righteous people are blessed with angels to protect them. And righteous people are blessed with angels to counteract the waswas of the shaitan. So when we come close to Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send an angel down. And the purpose and the job of that angel is to counteract the whisperings of shaitan. We know from the tradition that when a human is born, shaitan assigns one demon, one jinn, one shaitan is assigned to this person. Your job is to misguide this person. What we don't know is that in fact, when we turn to Allah, Allah assigns an angel. Many of us don't know this. It's in the hadith. Allah assigns an angel to counteract the role of that shaitan. So in fact, we have two entities from the other world, a demon or a jinn or a shaitan, and we have an angel as well. And the both of them are whispering. The one whispers evil thoughts, the other whispers good thoughts and tries to counteract. And it is up to us what we act upon. On the day of judgment, we can neither blame nor criticize the jinn or the angel, because all that they did was whisper to us. In the end, it is up to us to act. Neither the jinn nor the angel can force. It is we who decide to do. But Allah Azza wa Jal reveals, or sends down, I should say, an angel to try to help us against the shaitan. And in the end of the day, we have that, as we know, free will to decide what we want to do. As well, we learn that the angels make dua for the believers. Allah says in the Quran that the angels ask Allah to forgive the believers. And in the hadith we learn that there are specific good deeds that the angels ask Allah to bless those people who do them. Again, this is not comprehensive, but some of them. Number one, we'll mention those who give charity. The Prophet ﷺ said, every day two angels come down and they make a dua to Allah. Oh Allah, anyone who gives charity, give him more than what he gave. Give him back more than what he gave. And the other angel says, oh Allah, anybody who's stingy, deprive more than what he was stingy with. So angels make dua to Allah to bless the one who gives money. Number two, angels as well, they ask Allah to bless those who are teaching Islam, those who are spreading Islam. And this doesn't just mean giving khutbas and durus. If you're teaching your children Islam, if you're teaching your children how to pray, you teach your colleagues anything about Islam, the angels will make dua for you. Number three, those who come to the masajid, especially in darkness. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the angels make special dua for them. So frequenting the masajid. Number four, praying in saff al-awwal, that the Prophet sallallahu Allahu alayhi wasallam said that the angels yusalluna ala saff al-awwal, they ask Allah's salah, yani Allah's blessings and forgiveness upon the people who pray in the first row. Number five, those who eat suhoor. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that the angels ask Allah to bless those who eat suhoor. So we must and we should wake up for suhoor, and Allah azza wa jal's angels will be making dua for us that Allah makes our fast easy, that Allah blesses our fast. So the angels make dua for those who make suhoor. Number six, visiting the sick. The angels ask Allah to bless those who visit the sick. Number seven, when we make dua for others, angels make dua for us. So every time we raise our hands for our Muslim brother or sister, and this is one of the easiest ways, yet we are still so stingy, brothers and sisters. One of the easiest ways to get our dua responded to is that we make dua sincerely for other people. You want money? Raise your hands up and say, oh Allah, so and so is struggling with money. Bless him with wealth. Bless him with halal wealth. Guess what? An angel will say, Ameen. And oh Allah, may you also be given what you made dua for. You are sick, you want to be cured? Make dua for your fellow Muslims who are sick. Sincerely, the more sincere you are for them, the more sincere the angel will be for you. So you want something done, make dua for other people that it is done to them. And then the angel will make dua for you. So what a beautiful world we would live in if we really wanted good for other people. We will get that same good ourselves. So the angels make dua for the one who makes dua for his brother and sister. And number eight, I think I'm on, the saying the Fatiha. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that whoever says Ameen, and the angel's Ameen is the same time as his Ameen after the Fatiha, all of his sins will be forgiven. So when the Imam says the Fatiha, the angels that are around and listening, they all say Ameen. And we are supposed to also say Ameen. So we're supposed to coincide with that Ameen. And number nine, the angels ask Allah's forgiveness for any gathering that has gathered for the sake of knowledge and dhikr and salah. And they surround that gathering, as our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that they stop flying around and they come and they surround that gathering. They flap their wings around that gathering so that Allah's sakina comes, and they surround that gathering so that Allah's rahmah can be concentrated. So we pray that Allah azza wa jal makes our gatherings every night a gathering that angels come to. So the final point, brothers and sisters, is that what is the purpose of all of this to believe in the angels? The purpose is that a number of things, again, much can be said, time is limited. Some of the things that really strikes me about Iman and the angels. The angels are so perfect, so holy, so amazing. And one of the things that moves me the most, can you imagine how long they have been worshipping Allah without committing a single sin? For millennia, since before Adam until Judgment Day, how long that will be, it is beyond our human comprehension. And yet we learn in the hadith that when they hear the trumpet blown, and it is the same angel, it's not the angel's great-great-great-great-great-grandson, the same angel that has been worshipping Allah non-stop for millennia, millions, billions of years, beyond even a time frame, when they shall taste death for the one and only time, because even the angels shall die when the trumpet is blown the first time, then they'll be resurrected when the trumpet is blown the second time. For that interim, as we know, everything dies other than Al-Hayy Al-Qayyum. That interim, even the angels die. When the angels taste death, what will they say? The last phrase that will come from their mouths is a phrase that should shock all of us. رَبَّنَا مَا عَبَدْنَاكَ حَقَّ عِبَادَتِكَ سُبْحَانَكَ رَبَّنَا مَا عَبَدْنَاكَ حَقَّ عِبَادَتِكَ. How blessed are you, O Allah? We have not worshipped you the way you are deserving to be worshipped. This is what the angels say after what they have done. How about me and you? How can we possibly compare? And yet, one of the most amazing things, brothers and sisters, one would think, how can we possibly compete with the angels? Yet, the righteous of the children of Adam are more blessed in the eyes of Allah than the angels. How do we know this? The story of the creation. When Allah created Adam, what did He say to the angels? Bow down in respect. Subhanallah. How blessed is our Lord who has made us, if we are righteous, higher than even the angels. How blessed are we to have such a Lord. How fortunate are we to have such a Lord. He has raised our ranks even above that of the angels, but with that one condition, and that is that we are of the Salihin, we are of the righteous. The righteous of the children of Adam are a higher level than even the angels. And that is why in Jannah, the angels will come and say to us, Salamun alaykum bima sabartum fani'ma uqba ad-dar. The angels will congratulate us that when we enter Jannah, and they will say, peace be unto you because of what you have done, because of the patience you have had. And the final point, brothers and sisters, related to our month that we are in, Jibreel alayhi salam, and what will make us understand who is Jibreel, this mighty angel, this angel that has seen every single prophet and communicated directly with every prophet, that has done what only Allah knows. He was there throughout all of human history and before. This mighty angel, the mightiest of all angels, Jibreel, whom the Prophet himself asked, oh Jibreel, why don't you visit me more often? He wanted Jibreel to come. He wanted Jibreel to come, and he said to Jibreel, why don't you visit me more often? And Allah revealed a verse that we recite to this day, وَمَا نَتَنَزَّلُ إِلَّا بِأَمْرِ رَبِّكَ. We're only allowed to come if Allah gives us permission. I can't just come and visit you for a socialization. Allah has to send me, then I will come. He wanted to see Jibreel more and more and more. This mighty angel Jibreel no longer comes to this earth. That is it. It is gone. Ummi Ayman, the foster mother of the Prophet ﷺ, when Abu Bakr and Umar visited her after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, she began to cry. And they said, why are you crying? She said, I am crying because Allah's wahi has been cut permanently until Judgment Day. No more wahi of Allah will come. It's the end of the story with the death of the Prophet ﷺ. Yet on one day of the year, this mighty angel comes down to this earth. One night of the year, Jibreel himself comes down. As Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran, that al-malaikatu wal-ruhu fiha, the mighty spirit of Jibreel comes on Laylatul Qadr. And that is why some of the Sahaba and Tabi'un, when it was the last 10 nights, they would stand up in prayer and put on their best clothes and put on perfume. When they would be asked why, they would say, should we not prepare for the night that Jibreel himself is coming down? So Jibreel is coming down on these Laylatul Qadr, literally 10 days from now. That is the cycle when it begins. Should we not be excited? We are getting one of the mightiest creations of Allah to visit us. One of the ayati Rabbihil Kubra is coming to our lands. He's coming to this world. Should we not be excited? So much so Allah makes it a sign of Judgment Day. Allah mentions it and tells us, wal malaikatu wal ruhu fiha, Jibreel himself is coming down. Should we not be excited at the advent of this noble guest of Allah, the one whom even Rasulullah ﷺ wanted, come to us more often? And Jibreel himself wanted it, but he said, I can only come when Allah sends me down. Well, guess what? Allah will send him down in just a few nights. Let us be excited for that night. Let us make sure we're praying to Allah on that night. Let us make sure we're in dua, we're in salah. Because what if Jibreel were to pray for us? What if we're happening to be praying and Jibreel makes dua for us, where do you think our maqam will rise? So make sure we're standing on those 10 nights and make sure that we are praying to Allah on the night that Jibreel visits us. And inshallah, we'll continue our talks tomorrow. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.